GASP there, any of those are other acronyms. I want you to know, thanks to the wonders of computer graphics, no gerbils were actually exploded to make this documentary, except for one named Harold, whose agent was particularly annoying, so we flew Harold up really, really cool. And they tell me if that movie didn't arrive, they're going to show this thing called The Last Unicorn. And because we're running late for time, we're going to rearrange the order here. Normally there's a different order we do these things. We're going to run right and chase then come back and loop around. So let's introduce a certain guy right now. Peter S. Beagle. Peter, this is your microphone.
It's not right.
Come on. Start. Take this one, Molly.
That's all right. He talks too much anyway. I can't tell you how happy I am to be back in Santa Cruz. I came here first in 1961 on an afternoon's picnic with a few friends. I had no idea that I'd be... I can remember walking along the railroad tracks, which I think were functional then, in Aptos. I remember that. I had no idea that I'd be back a couple of years later with a new young family. And
yeah.
Directions to a place called Bonnyville. I lived at 2550 Smith Grade, off Empire Grade, and it was undoubtedly a shack, and I loved it. Oh, no, I loved it after the fact. I'm the only person who's probably nostalgic about it. But we had 29 acres of wild redwood land, and a stream that ran behind the house and went through a undoubtedly primitive filter, to put it mildly, and was the best water I've ever had. And I was the only beard I saw for miles. And the house came with a dog belonged to the landlord's brother, who was never there, and the dog's best friend, who was a pigeon. They went everywhere together. It was very long ago, very much another world. Very much another America in some ways. But walking down the mall, which has changed so much since the last time I was here, even that brings back astonishing memories. Turn a corner and remember a face. Look up at a building that isn't there anymore. And remember meeting people there, listening to music. But right now, there's anything.
We're not doing that.
What are we doing today?
Because they didn't have a mic, I couldn't interrupt you. They're replacing the battery in the other mic. We have a surprise for it. So I want you to put your hands together for your mayor, Lynn Robinson. Yeah, I talked too much.
Just have to indulge us for just a moment. And actually, first, something I would love to do, I want to see if I can do this. This is one of the treats I get to do as mayor, is see everyone that just is having a wonderful experience in Santa Cruz. And I have a feeling you're about to have that right here in this incredible theater. So, Peter, I don't know if you would indulge me, but I would love... you wouldn't mind turning around and being with the crowd. I want to take a picture with you with all your fans right now. Oh, it's going to work. I love it. Oh, I got it. I have to tell you, just it's such an honor to be the mayor. I pinch myself every day. But I realize every day I'm having an experience, and I need to record it every day because you're the experience. And we have something unspecial right now. I know it's a dream. And I have enough light to read this. I'm going to read a mayor's proclamation and indulge me. Because does anyone here in the room know something called the last unicorn? I've had the pleasure of watching you. There was a big, long line. You were so patient. It's a gorgeous day, and here you all are. I've seen some great outfits. I've seen some sparkly shoes. I know some folks are having their first experience at this incredible theater, which is one of those just beautiful, beautiful places, as Peter talks about. Santa Cruz has changed so much, and in some ways it stayed the same. But if anything, I know it's the heart and soul of Santa Cruz that does keep us connected. So listen to this proclamation. It's pretty special, and it's for someone pretty remarkable. City of Santa Cruz Mayor's Proclamation. Whereas Peter S. Spiegel, a former Santa Cruz resident, has made an extraordinary contribution to American arts as a novelist, short story writer, essayist, poet, lyricist, and in particular, for the gift of his most timeless fantasy creation, The Last Unicorn. And whereas, as a novel, The Last Unicorn has sold more than 6 million copies worldwide in 25 languages, as a graphic novel, it has won both acclaim and position on multiple bestseller lists, and as an animated movie, it has earned the love of tens of millions of fans and played a critical role in the historical merger of Japanese and American visual design aesthetics in film. And whereas Peter S. Spiegel wrote much of the story for The Last Unicorn while residing in Santa Cruz, and whereas few works in any field are truly iconic, and even fewer creators have earned that status, and whereas Peter S. Spiegel's creativity has inspired three generations of artists, writers, and performers, and will go on doing so as long as people read stories, sing songs, and put pen to paper to express the power of the human imagination. And whereas we honor Peter S. Spiegel for the gifts and joy that he has brought to so many hearts, wish him the best of luck in all his endeavors, and thank him for making the world brighter through his works and words, now, therefore, I, Lynn Robinson, the mayor of the city of Santa Cruz, do hereby proclaim Sunday, April 6, 2014, as Peter S. Spiegel Day in the city of Santa Cruz. And I urge all citizens to join me in expressing heartfelt appreciation for his decades of contributions to furthering the arts and the imagination of countless people locally and globally. Peter, we just are grateful and we thank you.
It figures Santa Cruz would improve the breed. Congratulations, Peter.
I accept them on your behalf. Thank you.
Normally, we do this differently. They have two mics. So we're going to launch the Q&A, and if the Q&A is done, we're going to describe some things for sale, and then we do the raffle. But because there are not two mics at the moment, they're running getting enough battery, I'm going to run around and pick the people who ask the questions and shout so he can hear your questions. It's a big theater, and he will answer.
Okay, let's start on this side. You can be the fastest.
I like this part with the scammers.
Shut up. Did you hear it?
What are your thoughts on the remake of The Last Unicorn?
A live-action remake?
Yes.
I have great hopes for that occurring, starting early next year in February 2015. I still remember good. Next February, the rights revert to us, which is a collective noun. But the point is that it will be possible. There are any number of actors, directors, studios, musicians, and so on, who have been increasingly asking questions about exactly this. When can we make a deal? So yeah, I do think it will happen. And I have the sworn word of Christopher Lee that even if he may have passed on by the time this takes place, I am not to worry about it because he has risen from the dead several times. Got it down. So now, yes. Yes, I do. I remember, I did that twice. Two different translations. I do remember indeed, especially because I remember I can read music just enough that I'd be sitting in the middle of the orchestra for all practical purposes, reading the score to remember where I came in, not here, not with those notes, but this whole bunch of notes here, yeah, that's me. Thank you for reminding me, I do. I can say this to Santa Cruz people especially because you must remember so much of this book was written in Bonnie Doon in the back bedroom of that shack, sweating and cursing and mumbling to myself. I quit that book once and would have quit it again if my wife and children hadn't urged me to push on. And the only part, well, two things. I remember the song lyrics, the incidental songs in the last year's book. That was fun. I love writing songs. And it's the one thing I really got from Tolkien, and I wasn't imitating at all. I did like the way he scattered songs and poems through the Lord of the Rings. I thought I'd like to do that. For the rest, what I do remember even then is writing the scene when Molly meets the unicorn for the first time. It's the part of the book I'm proudest of. I don't know how I did it. I was in my late 20s. I can't have known what life had been like for Molly. I really think she pulled that scene off more than I did. But that's the part I still look back to when I'm skimming through the last year. Which I don't do a lot, by the way.
Now you're in trouble. The audience have mics, too.
Go ahead, ask your question.
What gave you the idea of making the movie?
It was originally, before the movie, it was a book, which you'll read one day. And what gave me the idea was simply that I was sharing a house one summer, the summer of 1962, with a childhood friend who was a painter. And the only reason I started that story was that he was out every day working on a huge landscape. He'd come back every day with this big painting and more paint on the canvas every day. I just started The Last Unicorn almost out of nowhere to show him that I was working too. I wrote the line, "The unicorn lived in a lilac wood and she lived all alone." Now what? We talked about this a few years ago, and he told me, I hated that landscape. I would have cut that thing up and made four paintings out of it and just dropped it all together. But you were back in the cabin writing this book. And that summer I wrote 85 pages. Quit. Came to Santa Cruz. Learned how to take care of people and feed, put bread on the table, every now and then write something at The Last Unicorn, but mostly I'd had it. I'd had it if my wife hadn't prodded me into starting it again, I don't think I would have.
Next question.
Mr. Beagle, I have, I believe, one of the original copies, paperback copies of The Last Unicorn. And on the inside cover, it mentions the address of Roach Road. What was your position in life at that time? Were you in the process of writing the book, There in Freedom?
Wait a minute, I'm not sure. Roach Road? Mm-hmm. I may refer to it. No, I don't think I even used
it. It's in the book. That's what I was wondering about.
Oh, that's funny. I'll have to look at it. I lived on East Riando Road. No, that's Watson Road. I lived on Smith Grade, and about a quarter of a mile walk from Smith Grade to the shack. But when the first paperback came out, yeah, I was still living in that address, but I moved very shortly afterward. I have to see that to get clear on it. I'm not sure. Just competitiveness. As I was just saying, just because my roommate, my housemate, my childhood buddy, Bill Sigunik, who's a wonderful painter today, was working on a painting. This was going to be our working summer. And he was going to be painting, and I was going to be figuring what I'd do after publishing one novel and having the second one turned down by the publisher. I was very much at loose ends. And I just started writing The Last Unicorn for no other inspiration but that Phil kept coming back every day with more paint on the canvas. And I had to show him that I wasn't fooling around. I was a professional like him.
By the way, everybody, that version doesn't bear a lot of resemblance to the version you know. It was set in modern day. There was no Mommy Fortuna or Schmendrick or Haggard or any of that stuff. It's all, the butterfly was there, but that's about it.
And the unicorn in that version, learns about the disappearance of her people from a dragon who has had a very rough encounter with the 20th century. Is crawling back into the forest to, possibly to die, but certainly to recuperate. He mentions that his tail got run over by a semi, and he got a ticket for being an unlicensed, oversized vehicle. And he adds to the unicorn, "Oh, sure, I ate the policeman, but it didn't make me feel any better." There's some good bits in it.
Okay, and now we have a question from the Lady of Mafia.
Yes, indeed.
What are your thoughts on the success, the huge success of this story? Did you anticipate the huge resonation that this work would have with the world?
No, not for a minute. I just wanted the bloody thing done with. out of my hair. The only person who called it was the novelist, poet, Robert Nathan, who is as much an inspiration to me as Moore, I'm saying, as any other writer, certainly Moore. He was a good bit older than I. We became friends for the last 20 years of his life. And I sent him, I dedicated The Last Unicorn to him. And sent him the manuscript. And he read the manuscript, read right past the dedication, never noticed it. But he called me to say, "This is going to be the book people know who don't know that you ever wrote anything else. You're going to be stuck with this the way I'm stuck with Portrait of Jenny," which was one of his 40 novels that was made into a movie and overshadowed everything else he ever did. He said, he said, "You'll write books you possibly like better. And they may go out of print. People may not like them. They may get bad reviews, and nobody will notice them." And said, you'll love it and hate it at different times in your life. Said, "But the last analysis, finally," he said, "it does beat the hell out of not being remembered at all."
Okay, because we've got time for the movie, I'm going to have a question here, a question in the middle, you, and then somebody in the middle in the back. And Peter, be succinct.
Hi, I'm over here.
Right, so the light right in my eyes.
I was just wondering if you based the character Schmendrick and Mommy Fortuna on people you'd actually met in Santa Cruz.
No, not people. Landscape, yes. A lot of the landscape in The Last Unicorn does come from Santa Cruz County in general. when I knew, finally, I didn't know for a long time where the hell the unicorns were, and that they'd be coming out of the sea, I remember going down to the coast, I can't remember which beach, sitting there, I think I made three separate trips trying to imagine the unicorns appearing out of our legendary surf. And finally, that was the last part of the book I wrote. I went all the way to the end, and then went back and wrote that scene where the unicorns come out of the sea. It took me a couple of days. But people know. No, I don't think so. There are always bits and pieces of fragments of people you know, but I never put anybody into the book whole, and especially not this one. This was, even for me, one of a kind.
Now, a little bit of my job is tossing notes. A few years ago, he wrote a song called Deep Woods, The Unicorn Sings to Memory, which is the unicorn remembering the years centuries later. And in the liner notes for that song, which are printed online, he actually spun this elaborate story about how one day in Santa Cruz at a coffee shop, he befriended a couple of musicians named Jingley and Cully, and how he took them all, and they camped out overnight, and they told all these amazing stories, and now they're suing him because, of course, he stole everything from
them. You'll meet them. You meet them in the movie if you don't know.
Over here, Peter.
Over here is over there. Over there. Got it.
Okay. Hi. I just want to say it's so wonderful to be here. There was a month in my childhood, or a few months, where I watched this movie every single day. The songs used to make me and my sister cry. Big deal. So I was wondering, as a screenwriter, how much of a role and what kind of role did you play in the making of the movie, and what are your feelings about the representation of the book on film? Because the film is so wonderful.
I wrote the script, and by and large, they filmed it the way I wrote it, which is all any writer can ever get to say for the most part, unless you direct the film yourself. I didn't expect anything because I didn't like Rankin and Bass's work at all. I didn't like what they'd done with Tolkien. I hated Frosty the Bloody Snowman. Let alone Rudolph the Flipping Reindeer.
Rudolph the Big Reindeer.
And so I was overwhelmed by what they'd actually done. It was the best thing they ever did. And they went out and got a real songwriter instead of the one of the producers doing the lyrics and the music editor doing their songs. Actually went out and got Jimmy Webb, and they got real actors, most of whom knew the book and loved it, made that kind of difference. So I have absolutely no complaints.
Okay. Question here.
Thank you for being here. I wanted to know how much unicorn lore you had done research-wise, and now seeing that, our last unicorn is female, for years unicorns have been depicted as male, and now you forever have changed how unicorns are seen and thought of as female now. Did you go into that with any intention, or had you done any research on the lore of unicorns?
I had done one research you could do in 1962 in the Pittsfield, Massachusetts Library, because that's near where my friend Phil and I were summering. But it didn't occur to me, one way or the other, that I was creating the first female unicorn in literature. She was female from that first line. The unicorn lived in a lilac wood, and she lived all alone. That was that. I never thought of it one way or the other until I started getting hysterical phone calls from translators. I can remember one, especially from Romania, who kept insisting that there was no equivalent in his or her various languages. Was no way of creating a female unicorn. And there wasn't even a neutral tense, as neutral case as there is in German, to sidestep the issue. Because in Germany, at least the addition is Das letzte Einhorn. But no, I didn't mean to make trouble for anybody.
He's leaving something out. There's a story that's too good to let sit on the floor here. Your mother, elementary school.
Oh, Lord. Yes. When I was about 4 years old, my mother, who was an elementary school teacher, took me to meet her class. And I don't remember any of this. She told me about it. That I sat in front of her class that whole period and told them about unicorns. And when the class period was over, I don't think I bowed, I'm pretty sure I didn't, but I did say, thank you, I'll come back sometime and tell you more about unicorns.
And he did. All right, one last question, somewhere in the middle, somewhere in the middle, somewhere in the middle, somewhere in the middle. Someone's got a question, you're the question, you're the last question.
Okay. What are your thoughts about the heroine's journey? Because over the story, there's this huge transformation of this wild creature, and not for a spoiler alert or anything, but by the end, it's this really balanced being of that wildness and that sense of community and like the love and humanity that happened.
The unicorn, I'm glad you asked that. The unicorn changes. She'll never be what she was. At the end of the book, she knows it. And it's both, as she says, you know, it's... I don't want to paraphrase the movie or the book, but she regrets. And that's not possible for unicorn, yet she does. And she will be unique in that sense for the rest of her mortal life. And I don't think I was really aware of that until I got to that point. I'm not sure I was even aware of it sometime after I'd finished the book. But I'm old enough now to appreciate at least something of not so much the wear and tear of simply being alive, sentient in this world, but the things you learn, whether you want to learn them or not, and the things that stay with you that you never expected to have stay with you, and the emotions you didn't know you were capable of, whether you wanted to admit them or not. In a way, looking back, thinking about it, I've become the unicorn's journey myself. I think we all do. Thank you.
Zoom through a couple of these real quickly, but while I do that, first, hands in the air if you do not have a raffle ticket. The raffle god will give you a raffle ticket. If you don't have a raffle ticket, keep your hand in the air until the raffle god has brought you your raffle ticket. And while he's doing that, I'm going to do some show and tell. We have some things up for so you need to know about, rather than all of you individually. I'm going to tell you quickly. See this poster? It's a beautiful last unicorn poster. It's more than that. It's the entire novel. These are little tiny words.
Oh, snap.
Okay. This is from a company in Cambridge, Massachusetts called Lithographs. They turn books into art. We have some here. You can also order them online. The same company now makes tote bags for the book. And getting inside, reaching inside, t-shirts for the book. And you can wear the last unicorn. Now, we don't have any t-shirts here, but you can order them online from those people. We do have this t-shirt here, at least in some sizes. It says Team Beagle. And then it says, the unicornus ad astra, which means through unicorns to the stars. Okay, we have some of the cool things. Upstairs we have this. This is a fundraiser for independent theaters around the country. It's Iron Haggard. It's Haggard on the Iron Throne. And it's signed by both George Martin and Peter. Okay. Real quickly. This is something we got upstairs. It's a special item. Avram Davidson's Phoenix of the Mirror and a special story written by Peter with him and Avram as the main characters. It's too long a story to tell now. I will tell you upstairs. It's a cool book, collector's item. Another collector's item by accident, Unicorn Sonata. We have copies upstairs. They were all sold out. We found a sketch. Okay. Unicorn wands. These are by Amelia Sefton, Grand Rapids, Michigan. There's two bins of them upstairs. They're all unique, individual, and different. Because they're handcrafted, they're not inexpensive, they're $30. But what Amelia wants you to do, she wants you to look at them, enjoy them, and you find your unicorn. She wants you to rescue him from King Hagrid by buying him. Which, in this metaphor, would be me. And it's true, I love them all. If you buy them, I'm under. But she's happy, so buy them. Lastly, for those of you who don't know, there's a sequel story to Last Unicorn called Two Hearts. It's in this collection, The Line Between. And there's a prequel Schmendry story called The Woman Who Married the Man in the Moon. It's in this collection, Sleight of Hand. We have copies of it. Lastly, yes, almost lastly, his book, Tamsin, is back in print in a gorgeous edition. If you have not read this, you should. It's a wonderful ghost adventure story, fantastic story. You should read it. He's written more than this one. And finally, did you get tour cards? Because when you read the back, becoming a tour member gives you all kinds of purses. Lovely stuff coming up next year. It's going to treat you like gold. And I'm going to stop speaking at less speed of light. Done. Oh, what this? This one. We have gorgeous prints by Kubo, the designer of the characters. They're gorgeous fine art prints. They're cheap. We have those upstairs, and now let's do the raffle. So, raffle god, bring me the bag. Has everybody got raffle tickets?